When we're having the real talk about tackling the shadow pandemic, what do we really mean by that? Language is really powerful. And it describes our realities sometimes really well and other times not so well. UN Women has turned the trend of the increasing rate of violence against women and girls during COVID-19 as a shadow pandemic. What do you think of this term? And does it really accurately describe what is actually going on?
Now, Fatou, on your question, interestingly, a report that I'm about to launch tomorrow on SGBV in Ecuador, we wanted to call it the silent epidemic before the COVID pandemic hit. Now, is it a shadow pandemic? I think it's mostly a silent, really obvious pandemic that we've all been aware of for decades, although obviously recent movements have helped us put it in the limelight, and we hope that it will get far more attention in the coming years, so that there's a real change about it. But it is a correct framing. It's not shadow. It's there. It's very obvious. It just takes acceptance to really turn it into the pandemic that it really is. So I'll pause there and over to the next fierce feminist.
So on the question of language, I totally agree. I think it's really very important that we choose our words carefully, that we think about the meaning of those words, what they mean in a kind of literal sense, what they mean as part of a discourse and part of a narrative, and what they mean when we want to conjure imagination or push people into activism. So I agree with Ellen that indeed it's not a pandemic. When we're talking about gender-based violence, I think everybody in this room, wherever you're sitting in the world, knows that this is something that's been here all the time. Perhaps the only accuracy I can see in using the word shadow is the fact that your shadow is with you all the time, right? You can't get rid of it until you shine light. So violence is something that's in our societies. It's part of humanity. And it's not going to go away until we make a decision, put the resources in, find the political will, and address it through education. We're talking about education here. So from the smallest age to the highest level, this is a space in which we can really try to make a difference.
I completely echo the same sentiments with Madeline and Aline in terms of you cannot get rid of the shadow unless and until you focus your light. So I do have my own reservations of using the word shadow, because it's not shadow, it's obvious. It's out on your face that the whole pandemic has kind of exacerbated the whole issue of violence against women and girls. We need to invest more resources, more energy, which currently is lacking in all of the national and international strategies and plans of influential institutions like IMF and World Bank and all of these global institutions dishing out COVID money to countries. So yeah, I think all concerted activism should be focused around it.
If we call it a shadow pandemic, I think we kind of water down that impact of what this violence is. And so to me, it's a full-blown pandemic. It's just sad that, we are trying to get vaccines. Scientists are working around the clock to just make sure that everyone is healthy and everyone has a vaccine for the COVID-19 pandemic. But then I don't see people taking the same urgency for the violence and the GBV. So for me, that is a bit sad, because I think the same way we are trying to make sure that everyone is healthy, free from COVID, I think it should be the same urgency and the same seriousness we should be giving to violence, especially against women and girls.
In response to the question, I think I take the language used with a hint of salt, in the sense that I do want to agree with it, in the sense that with gender-based violence, historically, it's always been something that's shoved under the carpet. Every form of violence, but specifically sexual and gender-based violence, has always been pushed under the carpet, especially when you are a victim or somebody trying to speak up against it. So I could recognize it being a shadow in that way, because it's a pandemic. It's a crisis that we all recognize as a crisis that exists across the globe, but it's a crisis that we're not willing to acknowledge, at least beyond just the words of it.
Looking at the shadow language, shadow pandemic, I think I actually have a different point of it. I don't think I have a problem with the language, the shadow pandemic. That is, if you see from my point. Shadows for me are things that follow you everywhere. And like everyone rightly pointed out, when you have your lights on, it's as if your shadows go off. But the truth is, they don't stop existing. Increasing rate of violence against women and girls across the world is something that cannot be hidden, no matter how much light we want to shine, and no matter how much we want to sweep it down the carpet. It's something that will keep existing, just like the way we carry our shadows around.
And I think it's really important that we constantly and consistently interrogate language. And we use that, these types of phrases that are often coming from multilateral organizations and these catchphrases, et cetera, also coming from spaces of power, right, as activists and actors to say, but what does that really mean? What does it mean to shine a light? What does silence feel like? And how is it important to remind everyone, including all the various ways in which power operates, right, that this has, it's always been here. We're either choosing to not see it or act on it, but like Mary Jacobs said, your shadow never really leaves you.